Hi, in this video, I want to talk to you about the different forms of equity contribution in a project finance transaction. In the previous discussion that we had on the optimal capital structure, I discussed the debt versus equity and refinancing in a project finance deal. And in that discussion, I told you that in a project finance deal, the level of debt that can be raised depends on the future cash flow of the project and the importance of the financial model when it comes to the appraisal. So during that discussion, we also discussed that the lenders, no matter how strong the future cash flow of the projects are, the lenders, they require the investor to contribute also in the financing of the project. And that is because of the concept of the skin in the game. Because if you're not investing in something, you are not invested in it. So in order to keep the commitment of the investors into the project, into the success of the project, the lenders require the investors to also put money into the deal. So in today's discussion, we're going to talk about the different forms of equity that can be used to finance a typical project finance deal. However, before we dive into the topic, for those of you who don't know me, hi, my name is Hedieh. I made financial modeling my profession as well as my passion, and my aim here in YouTube is to just make you a better financial modeler. So if that sounds like something you're interested in, please consider subscribing to my channel. When it comes to equity, what are the different forms that the shareholders can contribute in the financing of the project? The most common ones are pure equity, shareholder loan, and there are some short-term facilities as well, like the letter of credit and also bridge loan, equity bridge loan. But these are, as I said, mostly short-term. In this video, we're going to mainly talk about the shareholder loan and pure equity. Okay, so let's talk about pure equity. It is also called under share capital or base equity and sometimes simply equity. It is mostly the most expensive source of financing, and this is because it is has the highest risk. In the discussion on a cash flow waterfall, when we discussed the order of a cash flow waterfall, we saw that the shareholder, any payment to shareholders are subordinated to the operating expenses, payment to any contractors, of course, payment to the lenders, all of them. So the last one that gets the money are the shareholders. So they are the most at risk. If things go wrong, they will lose their capital. So they are highly at risk. So that's why they are the most expensive source of financing. In terms of the accounting in the balance sheet, the equity, pure equity, comes under the equity account. And any payment, and there are no fixed payments, you know, for compensating the equity contribution in forms of pure equity. The investors, they don't have any fixed payments under any contracts. So that like lenders, they know exactly how much they will be paid. If things go as usual, they know exactly how much they will get paid. However, the shareholders and investors, their payments, it's not fixed, and it depends on the cash flow availability in a cash flow waterfall. And we will discuss that in more details when we look at a financial model. Regarding shareholder loan, it's another source of financing. It is usually priced at the same price as the pure equity, meaning that the investors, when they want to come into the project, they have a certain required return. They know exactly how much they want, their expectation. And based on that, usually the shareholder loan is priced at the same rate as the required return on equity. In terms of the accounting and in the balance sheet, the shareholder loan is recorded under a long-term liability like any other loan. However, just know that in terms of the cash flow and the cash flow waterfall, the shareholder loan is fully subordinated to any payments under senior lenders or operating expenses, and it's treated the same as dividends. When it comes to the lender's perspective, It doesn't matter. So all the lockups, all the covenants that the lenders require for the distribution is going to also apply to the shareholder, any payment on the shareholder loan. Okay, so it is a debt under the balance sheet. However, it is fully subordinated. Okay, now the question is, what is the sponsor preference? Pure equity or shareholder loan? And why? The answer is, it depends. So there are two reasons that I want to discuss here. The first one is tax shield. In some jurisdiction, we know that any payments under the shareholder loan, any interest payment under the shareholder loan is tax deductible. So it is beneficial from the point of view of the investors to raise shareholder loan instead of pure equity because it has some tax benefits. However, when we discuss about the tax benefits and the tax shield and all that, we need to look at the big picture and we need to look at how these instruments are taxed in a specific country that our project is situated. So when we come to the discussion on the financial model, I will discuss it in more details. However, you need to know exactly how much the interest on the shareholder loan is taxed and all the rest before you can do this evaluation. So one of the benefits of having a shareholder loan is the tax shield and the deductibility of interest on shareholder loan. So you pay less corporate income tax. The other reason why investors go for shareholder loan is to avoid cash trap, because as we know, you're not allowed to distribute any dividend unless you are generating any profit or the project is generating profit, okay? However, so there might be cases where there are cash sitting in an account. However, when it comes to the P&L, your profit and loss statement, it is showing losses. It is because of the accounting treatment of depreciation, accelerated depreciation, or different reasons. You might not be profitable, but you might have some cash sitting in your project account. Having a shareholder loan will allow you to extract cash in those years where you're not generating profit, and you can distribute them as a shareholder loan interest or shareholder loan principal. Okay, so that's one of the main reasons to raise the shareholder loan. So now that you have all this in mind, we're going to go and see how we can apply them in a financial model. Okay, so as we said, in order to understand and answer the question of how much shareholder loan we need to put and how much pure equity, we need to have a flexible financial model and report all the assumptions regarding the tax and the lender's covenant and see what is the level of shareholder loan that we need to raise and what is the level of pure equity that the investors need to contribute. So I just gonna go through a typical financial model. However, the step one is to basically start with the inputs. So here is a financial model. I have a worksheet dedicated to my constant inputs. And in the financing section of the assumptions, I'm gonna have a section for the shareholder loan, okay? So first of all, in terms of the sizing of the shareholder loan versus equity, in this model, I use a percentage. So in a financing, in the sources and uses of funds statement, once we know exactly how much debt, senior debt we can raise, and the remaining needs to come from the equity. So we have the total equity, then, and we have a drawdown schedule for that equity. So what I'm gonna do is that I'm gonna use these percentages, and I'm gonna say 40% of the total equity needs to be invested as under share capital, and the remaining 60% will come as shareholder loan. And of course, as you can see here, I have the flexibility and I can change these assumptions and see the impact on the equity IRR and all the different metrics that I want to monitor. Okay, so the other set of assumptions that I want to have is the tenor for the shareholder loan. However, that tenor doesn't mean much, because as we know, you need to have flexibility when it comes to the shareholder loan. You have to look at your cash flow waterfall and the cash flow available for payments to shareholder, and whatever is available, you're going to pay it either under dividends or the shareholder loan, and it doesn't make much difference in terms of the lenders or the government, whoever other parties that are involved. It doesn't matter. They look at all of these, whether it's a shareholder loan, whether it's a dividends, it's makes all payments to investors, okay? However, investors, from their point of view, they need to evaluate and see whether it's better for them to have a more interest payment, more principal payment, more dividends payment. All of these are of concern of the investors. So you're going to reflect the tenor, and however, as we're going to look at the calculation blocks, and you need to go beyond the tenor if, of course, there is no cash availability over the tenor of 15 years is not enough. You can go beyond the 15 years. So you need to accommodate the flexibility. The other important assumption is, of course, the interest rate on the shareholder loan. This can be zero. For example, if you are working in a country where the interest is taxed, this is all subject to the tax audit and the tax advisor's recommendation. However, you can also have a shareholder loan which is priced at 0%. Okay, but most of the time it is priced as the same price as the equity. And the other parameter that I have included in this model is cash sweep. So how do I use cash sweep? It's basically I take the line in the cash flow waterfall. Let me take you to the cash flow waterfall statement in the model, which is under IFS, Integrated Financial Statements. So this is the cash flow waterfall. I have the operating cash flow available for debt service, cash flow available for the debt service reserve account, and all that, until I come to this line, which is called cash flow available for shareholder loan payment. So this line, this is the line that is the cash available for investors. It can be either on the shareholder loan or it can be as dividends, okay? And I use this cash sweep percentage to say that if there is any shareholder loan, for example, that 90% of this line, this cash flow available for shareholder, will go for the payment of shareholder loan interest and principal, and the remaining 10% will go as dividends. And you can see it here, that is actually the case. So these are, I guess, all the assumptions that I need for calculating the different cash flows related to the shareholder loan. Now the next step is to do the calculations. So I put the shareholder loan in my equity under the equity worksheet. You can do it under the debt sheet, it doesn't matter. This is just because it comes under debt, it can come under the debt sheet. However, I prefer to put it under the equity sheet. So anything that goes to the investors, I put it on a separate sheet under equity. However, I mean, this kind of structuring of your worksheet, as I always say, it's just your own preference, however you are comfortable, however it is easier for you to explain it to your client or to your team. You just do it as you wish. So next step is, once you have laid out your assumptions, is to start doing the calculations. So the first thing is to create the aim. The aim is to basically create this balance. So you start with the beginning balance, and then you have the drawdown and the interest during construction. Of course, during construction, I don't think you pay any interest. You mainly want to capitalize it and then pay it later as principal. I have not come across any project where interest on shareholder loan was paid during construction. And then the next line in our balance is the shareholder loan deferred interest, because as I said again, any payment on the shareholder loan is subject to cash availability, and it's not going to cause any kind of default or anything. So if there is not enough cash, you can defer it. Of course, in the base case, you don't expect any deferral. However, in the down cases, there might be in some periods in the model where there is no cash, and you have to have the flexibility to defer that payment until you have enough cash to repay it, okay? And then, of course, you just pay your shareholder loan, and the balance at the end of the, at some point in the project needs to be zero, which is the case. So we have a check as well to check for that. So just you need to make sure that the shareholder loan is fully repaid, okay? So now when it comes to payment on the shareholder loan, as I said, it all depends on the cash availability. So unlike the any senior debt service where you say that this interest and principal is due and needs to be paid, and if it is not paid, or if there is not enough cash to pay the interest on the senior lender, your model will create some errors and it will tell you that there is not enough cash to pay and there is something that you need to check, and the debt service cover ratios will also show that. So there will be some checks and alerts to show you that there is no cash. However, when it comes to the shareholder loan, you need to allow that flex. You still can create some alerts to say that there was some problems with the payment of the shareholder loan in some periods in the model. However, you need to create that flexibility and allow for the check. So as you can see here in this line, I have a cash flow and cash sweep. In this line is the flag that I created for the payment of dividends or any shareholder loan. So for the discussion on the covenants and the distribution lockout, I'm going to put the lockups. I'm going to put the link down below. I discussed it previously in more detail of the different covenants, different lockup ratios that you need to create. And it doesn't mean that if cash is available, you can distribute it to the investors. It needs to go through a round of conditions and requirements by the lenders. And if they are satisfied, then you can distribute. And that flag is doing that job. It's just checking for the satisfaction of these requirements. And if it is, it is a one that it's going to allow the distribution either on the shareholder loan or dividends. Okay, so once we have this, so this is the cash available for shareholder loan interest. So the first order is the payment of interest. So we have a 10% interest on the shareholder loan. We're going to calculate how much interest is due. Okay, and then based on this line which we say cash available for shareholder loan interest, we're going to basically take the minimum of the two, and the what goes as interest paid is going to be basically dependent on the cash availability. Once we have that, the same thing applies for the principal repayment. Again, it's going to be based on the availability of cash. So we take basically the minimum of cash available. You see here, this is how much is due under the principal repayment of the shareholder loan. And this line is just basically taking the cash available for shareholder. It's minimum of this cash available for payment of principal under the shareholder and what is actually due under the principal under the shareholder loan. So once we have these line items in principal and interest, we can go and just link them in a cash flow waterfall to get to the line that we call cash flow available for dividends. So as you can see here, the remaining will be distributed as dividend. And at this point in time, when in this period in 2038, in this model, when I am done repaying the shareholder loan, everything will be distributed as dividend, basically in the last 5 years of the project. Okay, so I hope this was clear. If you have any questions or anything, please let me know. I'm just going to also post a blog post on the same topic on my website, www.phoenixmode.com, that you can read. And if you have any questions, you can just write to me. I will answer for sure. Hope to see you in my next video. Thank you for watching. Bye. If you want to learn how to build better financial models, check out my online course on financial model spreadsheet design at courses.phoenixmode.com.